Айде следващия IMFC.
Let me first thank the organizers and David Gada for the kind invitation. It's indeed a great pleasure for me to be here, to be doing this conference in Sofia, and also to share a few insights about the Croatian experience, about the Euro introduction, and also to be here to support fellow Bulgarians on their path to Euro introduction. While preparing my thoughts for today's conference, I put on the paper three key messages that I would like to put on the floor here. The first message is Euro is a huge benefit and it pays off every effort to introduce it. This is so in particular for a small open economy that is highly euroized and strongly integrated in Eurozone both financially and trade-wise. For such a country, benefits by far outweigh costs, already in a short run, but even more in a long run. Since benefits are general, in general, are permanent in nature, while costs are primarily one-off. If you ask what is a single most important benefit of Euro introduction in Greece, that would definitely be a practical removal of foreign exchange risk from the economy. I can elaborate this in more detail later on if needed, but what I want to stress here is that this risk is often by far underestimated by broader public, since central bank policy of maintaining exchange rate stability is taken for granted. Nonetheless, there are very tangible benefits that public perceives well. These are interest rates and transaction costs. These benefits become particularly visible in crisis time. I can tell the first-hand experience of Croatia. In our case, interest rates already converged since 2017, when we started our euro journey, by almost 200 basis points. And today, they are close to interest rates in the Eurozone. Alfred, in his address, explained the dynamics of the interest rates around, and what we clearly see, especially after the last crisis, the Ukrainian crisis, that interest rates in countries like Hungary, Poland, Czech Republic, so those countries which decided not to go towards the euro introduction, they increased tremendously. And these days for the enterprises and households, the interest rates there are at the 6, 8 or even 10% depending on the country. In the Eurozone, interest rates increased, but just for a bit. So they increased to some levels of say 3%. And in Croatia, they are also there, perhaps a little bit higher than that. So although we are yet not part of the Eurozone, markets are perceiving Croatia as being part of the Eurozone tomorrow. So basically, we are already enjoying this benefit of stability. All in all, no question, an economy of a country with euro introduction becomes stronger, more competitive, and more resilient to crisis. As I said, Croatia is very good example. The second message. Introducing euro is ultimately a political decision, not economic one. But economic analysis may facilitate this decision. Euro introduction in general is a very complex process, which includes numerous stakeholders, both at home and outside the country. It also involves general public. Their perception matters. There are few who do understand, in an analytical sense, what euro introduction can bring to the economy of a country. Usually, these few come from a central bank. And they have to talk to leaders in government and Ministry of Finance. And for the success, a key ingredient there is not only specific knowledge, but good communication and mutual trust. Once internal political will for euro introduction is forged, the long journey of euro introduction can start. This journey involves good organization of the process, good coordination among key domestic stakeholders, government, Ministry of Finance and Central Bank, as well as clear communication with EU institutions and agreement on necessary steps, including policy measures. It also includes communication towards general public. For the sake of the time, I do not intend here to tell the story how it went to
Croatia,
but it is a good story. We started in late 2016, and you know how it ends. Perhaps I can tell you only one short insight about how the rhetoric of domestic euro critics changed over time in our
lives.
No surprise, we had those who were against euro. They were vocal, and they had very good access to all media. In the beginning, they were telling the story that Croatia was not ready for Europe. As time was passing by, Croatia exited from the EGP in 2018. In 2019, it was not assessed anymore as a country with excessive macroeconomic imbalances. In 2021, Croatia had a very strong V-shaped recovery from COVID crisis. And in the same year, it was assessed as a country having no macroeconomic imbalances at all. So when euro critics in 2022 realized that Croatia was about to get a green light in convergence report for euro introduction, which is an ultimate proof that country is ready, some of the euro critics changed their rhetoric, starting to say that Croatia might be ready for the euro, but eurozone is not ready for Croatia, meaning that Croatia should wait with euro introduction until eurozone improves its institutional weaknesses. With this, you got a bit of a sense how interesting was part of public debate in Croatia. Of course, we were mindful of a public perception related to euro introduction. We conducted surveys to reveal public sentiment on the euro, and from them we knew that there was less than 20% of population that was strictly against euro. But we also knew that there was approximately 25% of population against the EU. There were those who were conditionally in favor, around 25%, and those who were clearly in favor, around 45%. Some 10% of population was undecided. I just have to underline that these were our surveys. If you go to Eurobarometer survey, which is very simple, asking yes or no, you would see that results there were 55-60% in favor of the euro, 40% against the euro. But from this survey, we basically got this undecided, but we also got this conditionally in favor. And we, when you ask these who are conditionally in favor, what under what condition you would be for the euro, they would almost always answer that if our living standards stay the same or improves, we are for the euro. And this story, or better to say, this experience, whether they would be better off or not, can be basically seen only once the euro is introduced. So there is kind of a time inconsistency, so you cannot wait till ever, so to say. Turning back, and that was a stance, so of these numbers that I told you, that was a stance without any communication campaign for the euro mandate. So without communication campaign, we had these results. So it was obvious that with the euro project, we were knocking on the open door. Here I come to my third message. Technical, operational, and administrative preparations for the euro can be done in approximately 15 months. My colleague Vasle said that they were preparing for 3 years. We also heard of countries who said you can't do it in less than 18 months. We did it in 15 months. So it's doable. It is a very demanding process with numerous stakeholders, and perhaps the most challenging part is related to time inconsistency problem. One has to start full-fledged preparations, which for private companies, banks in particular, means spending serious resources well before political decision of EU Council is made. So you are aware of the fact that EU Council comes only 6 months before, and you have to start preparations well before that time. So people have to start spending money. Hence, communication is increasingly complex as all involved stakeholders have to get right incentives to start preparations, in other words, to spend money. On the other hand, both central bank and government have to stay firmly committed to the objective and to keep sending unambiguous signal to both domestic and external partners. In Croatia's case, we communicated to all partners that we were committed to 1st January 2023, full stop. But that the final decision would depend on fulfilling Maastricht criteria, of course, and that it would come only 6 months before the date of euro introduction. And we underlined there that we had no comfort to start preparations that, hence we urged everyone to start preparations well in advance. To conclude, we put a lot of energy into the process of euro introduction, and we had a rock solid ownership of the entire process. In the end, it was a success story. We are truly, truly happy and proud. Our success would not be possible, of course, without the support from colleagues from the EU institutions. And we are glad when they also see this process of our euro introduction as their personal and institutional success. For all, this was indeed a great achievement. I wish my Bulgarian colleagues every success with finalization of their process. No question, the Croatian National Bank stands ready to support you. Thank you.
Като сте толкова успешни, защо не говориш на словенски поне?
I am also from a small open economy, from one of the original countries that adopted the euro, and I will support all the lessons that have been brought out already by the colleagues from other small open economies on the benefits of the euro for a small open economy. But let me start perhaps with just one anecdote, why I'm so happy to be here. I am back in Sofia. I was here in 1994 and 1995 negotiating with the IMF on your commercial debt restructuring program, and we tried to convince your government at the time to adopt a currency board. So it's even before the dates you mentioned that we did this. The commercial debt restructuring was successful, and the currency board took another 3 years before you adopted it. But if you had told me then, and this was just after the Soviet Union had disintegrated, and you had said to me, Art, in your lifetime, you will come back to Sofia at the eve of the moment that Bulgaria will adopt the same currency that your country has, I would have said, keep on dreaming. So let me say to you, to Bulgaria, congratulations. You have come a really, really long way, and I'm really impressed by what I've seen in Sofia, all these buildings, even this building. This has all come about in this generation since I was here last time. I have only two messages for you. The first is on convergence, and I know the Deputy President mentioned it at the beginning, that real convergence is essential to ensure the sustainability of the euro area. We are extremely integrated financially, socially, we even have freedom of labor mobility, and in order to ensure that these countries that work together are in a common, sustainable union, there has to be real convergence. Before the euro was introduced, there was a lively debate, an academic debate, whether introducing the euro would in and of itself trigger real convergence. Some people said, of course there will be convergence because the business cycles will become more integrated, and the others said, no, there will not be real convergence because countries will specialize. And now 20 years later, we know what the truth is. The empirical truth is that joining the euro area does not support real convergence in and of itself. What we saw in the first 10 years of the euro was that financial cycles between countries diverged enormously. We had credit booms in some countries, and in other countries like mine and like Germany, a very moderate expansion. And this difference led to the great financial crisis of 2007 and 2008, and subsequently also to the euro area crisis of 2012. So this is an important lesson for Bulgaria. Real convergence does not happen by itself. You have to do it. You have to pursue the right structural policies, the right institutional policies, central bank independence, I would underscore, is very important to have the right checks and balances in your institutional structure, but also structural rules, infrastructure, education, labor market participation, pension reforms. These are all important for you to really sustain your real convergence towards the other countries in the euro area. So that's the first message. The second message is, all right, what happens when you join the euro area? Let me give you good news, but also mixed news. The good news is, when you join the euro area, you will receive a bonus. And you will say, well, what sort of bonus? Your whole economy is going to have a bonus. So interest rates are going to go down for everyone. Risk premia are going to go down for everyone. And there's going to be pressure from financial markets, from institutional investors, from funds to allocate some of their euro area money to Bulgaria. Because if you are in London or in Amsterdam and you have a euro area sovereign bond fund, investment fund, and Bulgaria joins the euro area, you have to allocate a few percentage points to Bulgaria. So you are going to get inflows. You are going to get lower risk premia. This is the bonus you are going to get. And what happens? So what happens? This means that market discipline will decline. You will be disciplined less by markets. So it's going to be even more important that you do the right thing. It's going to be even more important. Bad policies will not be punished quickly. But mind you, ultimately, they do get punished. Market discipline in the euro area is late, it's abrupt, and it's sometimes also excessive. And so don't wait until the markets discipline you. Do it before. And make sure you are in there. Because if you do the right policies, I can tell you, coming from the Netherlands, well, we like seeing the GDP per capita graphs and then printing the Netherlands with the color orange, because it goes like this since we joined the euro.
Oh, Hitler.
But there are also countries where GDP per capita is being flat.
Oh,
so what I'm saying is, good policies pay off. And so let me just conclude. Convergence doesn't come about by itself. You are set to profit from a bonus when you join, but use it wisely, and we from the Netherlands would really welcome you in the zone of monetary stability and financial stability. Thank you.
Yeah, so I'm going to turn first to Bosch. For the Euro.